In the last video, we learned some basics about how the heap works, and now we want to apply this to heap level 1 from exploit exercises protostar to solve it. Actually, I want to try something. We do some role playing. Let's first be the security researcher who wants to find a bug to exploit in this binary. Afterwards, we play developer trying to understand the exploit to fix the issue. So we put on our black hoodie and get started. First, we open the binary heap1 in GDB and execute it. We get a segfault. And it also shows us that the segfault was caused by string copy because it tried to copy a string from the address 0 to this other address here. And 0 is obviously not valid memory, so it crashes. We know how Linux binaries work, so we make an educated guess that this application might require some input and we try the arguments. Run with AAAA. Again, another segfault. But the attentive viewer will notice that the address is now different. So this is a different string copy, which again can't copy from address 0. So we guess that it requires another argument. And this time the program runs through without errors. Now we try to find a bug. So the simplest thing to do is we just throw some long inputs at the program and see if something happens. So for the first argument, I choose to do a pattern with letters, and for the second argument, I do numbers, just so I could identify them if something would occur. We run that and we get a different segfault. Again, because of string copy, but this time the destination address looks invalid, not the source address. It tried to copy the string with the numbers, which we know is the second argument, to the address 464646, which is the hex code for FFFF. So whatever happened, we somehow overwrote an address that is used as the destination of string copy. And this means we can now use the first argument to fully control where we want to write, and we can fully choose what to write with the second argument. Now we have a lot of freedom what we can overwrite. For example, we can overwrite the return pointer on the stack to redirect code execution, or we can overwrite an entry of the global offset table, which I explained in a previous video, to achieve the same. Let's do the latter one. It's usually more reliable than the stack, which likes to move around a lot. So let's check what kind of function is called after the evil string copy. We can peek into the source code and see that there's a printf, and we could assume that we want to overwrite printf on the global offset table, but that is deceiving. That's not the case. Let's better stick to the assembly. First of all, we have to find the location from where we were calling the string copy. We can use backtrace for that, which will look at the stack and the stored return pointers to figure out where we are. As a side note, if you found a bug that smashes the stack, then the backtrace cannot make much sense of it anymore, so it doesn't always work. And here we can see that currently we are in string copy, but we were coming from this address. So let's set the disassembly flavor to, say, an Intel syntax and disassemble this address. This will now disassemble the whole function this address belongs to. Our address ended in 5A, so we are here after the string copy. And as you can see, there is a call to puts next, which is, by the way, not printf like in the source code. That's because the compiler replaced the printf with puts for optimization reasons. Okay, so let's overwrite the global offset table entry for puts. As shown in the GOT video, we can figure out the address of puts by first disassembling the function trampoline in the procedure linkage table, which would now jump to an address stored at this address. So this means this is the address of the puts global offset table entry. So this is the target we want to write to. Thus, we place it in the first argument. GDB run, but we use backticks in the first argument to execute bin echo. As you know, echo simply outputs whatever you pass to it as arguments, and we can use that to get characters with hex values we can't type. For example, the hex value 8. So echo minus ne. Minus n because we don't want that echo places a new line at the end of the output, and minus e because we want echo to convert hex escaped numbers into raw characters. Just to make sure everything works, we echo the whole test string up to the f's again. Now, echo inside the backticks will execute, and the output of that will be placed inside of the quotes as the first argument. And when we run this, we get the same segfault as before, so all is fine. Next step is obviously to replace these f's with the address of the puts global offset table entry. and when we now run it, we get a seg fault somewhere else. This time because of 30, 30, 30, 30, which is ASCII 4000. And when we look at the registers with info registers, we can see that we successfully got control of EIP, which means we can now redirect code anywhere we want. In this case, we want to call winner. Winner has this address here. So we place that into the second argument instead of argv2, but using echo and backticks. We execute it and we get winner, which also works great outside of GDB. In summary, we can say this. We identified a bug by guessing and playing around with it. Through GDB, we learned that somehow we can control the destination of a string copy, and we learned we even control what we want to copy. And we abused that to override the function address of puts to redirect code execution to the winner function. All without knowing why this even happened and not even knowing that the heap was involved at all. Being a good security researcher, we create a write-up, an advisory for this, providing our proof of concept exploit as well as some additional information that might help the developer. Now let's change sides and become the developer. We take off our black hoodie and we put on our gray hoodie because that's what developers wear. So we just got this email from this dude who found a bug in our program. He even provided a proof of concept exploit with it. Now we want to figure out why and how this happened so we can fix it. In the advisory, it says that it has to do something with string copy. So we read the manual about string copy and have this oh shit moment when we realize we didn't even read the documentation that would have told us what a bad idea that was. So now we could fix that, for example using string and copy, or use strlen to check the length before we copy it and then exit. But because we are a good developer, we try to learn from this advisory and try to understand how the exploit exactly works. In the last video, the heap malloc introduction video, we already thought about how the heap should look like from this program. So let's see how it looks in reality. To do this, let's set a breakpoint after each malloc and string copy. We disassemble main and look for all those calls and set breakpoints afterwards. Then we run it with the proof of concept exploit arguments and we hit the first breakpoint. So now the first malloc happened and the result of malloc is in EAX. So EAX contains the address on the heap where we have enough space for the internet struct I1. And we can look at this address and we can see it's simply zero. With info prop mappings, we can see the memory segments and there's also the heap and we can have a look at that. Oh, maybe it's a good idea to add this heap output as a GDB hook as well, so we see it automatically at each breakpoint. So define hook stop x64 word in hex, the address end. So if we now continue, we should set the priority of I1 to 1 and then malloc for the name. Let's have a closer look at the heap. So as we learned, the I1 variable points here. So this is where the struct starts and you can see the first attribute, which is the priority set to 1. And before that, we have the heap metadata, the chunk header, which contains the length of this chunk, including the last bit set to 1, which means that the previous block is not free, it's in use. And what we see is what we expected. We see here two allocate chunks for 8 bytes, including the headers, they are 16 bytes. Another cool thing we can do is define a variable I1 in GDB and set it to the address of this object. And we can even add the type of this variable with struct internet, and now we can print this variable I1 and GDB can display us the attributes priority and name. And we can see that priority is 1 and name is still 0 because we have allocated memory for the name but not yet assigned it to the I1 attribute name. If we continue to the next breakpoint, the address of the name got assigned and the I2 object got allocated. And the result of malloc is again in EAX. That's the address of the I2 object. So we can also define the variable I2 in GDB, and when we print that we can see that it's still empty. Now if we continue, the priority of I2 should be set to 2, which we can verify by looking at the heap memory as well when we print the I2 object. And also all of our mallocs are done now. And if we compare that what we expected in the earlier video, we can see that it fits perfectly. There's only one thing we didn't talk about yet, and that's this big value after all the chunks at the end. Well, this area down here is all free memory, and in exploitation terms, this is often referred to as the wilderness. This number is the remaining size of the heap. This whole thing is basically a huge heap chunk, and that number is the length. A while ago, I made a three-part video about the cookbook challenge from a CTF, and that exploit abuses this number to redirect code execution. It's super awesome, you should watch it. Anyway, right now the name of I1 is still empty string, but this is about to change with the next breakpoint, because we are about to execute the first string copy, which copies this super long first argument. Continue. Now, first thing we notice is here in the heap memory, those ASCII characters appear and it looks like they have overwritten a lot of stuff on the heap. What earlier was supposed to be the chunk header metadata, like the size, is now 4444. Now let's have a look at the objects I1 and I2. So I1 looks fine. I1 has still priority 1 and the name with the string that was passed to it. How about I2? That looks fucked. Priority is now a super huge number. In fact, that's just 4545545 in decimal, that's the ease. And the address where the name is stored is now pointing somewhere completely else. And now the next string copy will take I2 name, which is pointing to some bad memory, and try to copy there the second argument. Really freaking awesome. So this challenge showed one aspect of heap exploits. It doesn't attack the heap algorithm itself, it attacks the application which uses objects on the heap that we can modify because we have overwritten stuff. And those modified objects then bend the execution flow. Cool, huh?